हरे कृष्णा, वेलकम एवरीबडी फॉर द लॉन्ग ब्रेक। कंटिन्यू फ्रॉम वेयर वी स्टॉप्ड। एनीबडी रिमेंबर्स व्हाट वी वर डिस्कसिंग लास्ट?
या हरे कृष्णा प्रभु जी,
यस मदर,
वी डिस्कस्ड टू काइंड्स ऑफ ड्यूटीज वी हैव एंड देयर आर टू स्टेट्स ऑफ लिविंग. Either we are in liberated state or we are in a conditional state. Liberated state means we have risen above the bodily platform, and conditional state means we are within the bodily platform.
Conditioned state.
Yeah. Means you explained that we don't think we are not this body. We are still living in the bodily platform, I and mine. So you explained about that. And you said like there are four varnas and four ashramas. Varnas are like Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Ashramas is Brahmacharya, Grihastha, and Vanaprastha, and Sannyasi. And you mentioned that whatever caste system we have today, it is due to selfish motives of the people. Earlier, it used to be based on guna and karma and not based on birth. It's on nature and the quality of work the person do. And you mentioned the, like, you know, Brahmanas, they used to organize life in such a way that we realize a Supreme Lord. So that was the role of Brahmana. And Kshatriya used to belong to administrative class. They used to use their intelligence for managing and for organizing and managing things. They were basically administrative works they used to do, like king, rulers, and all those people. And they used to take guidance from Brahmana so that they get the knowledge and organize the society in such a way that people achieve their real goal of life.
Yes.
And you also mentioned that previously they used to collect 25% of taxation and all those things.
Yes.
So that was collected to facilitate to people to realize the goal of life.
Yeah.
And Kshatriya's duty were to protect people from harm. And you also mentioned that why they go to forest and kill animals, wild animals. The reason you mentioned was they used to kill animals. If they don't kill, they can't kill their enemy in the war, something of that sort you explained. And Vaishyas, they belong to businessmen class. They used to do krishi, goraksha, then vanijya, more of like barter system. They used to create balance in the society. And today they are more focused on industries and all. And you mentioned about Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru thing, how we said like agriculture is a backward economy and industrial revolution is the only way, he said. And because of this, we ended up in importing the basic things which we need for our country. Previously, we used to grow that in our country itself.
Mm-hmm.
And how Jersey cow milk has spoiled our health, this you explained. And you also said that Krishna's occupation was a cow herding. This was given up. Krishna's land is called Goloka. You mentioned that. And you also mentioned that having this kind of Jersey milk, how people's health has gone for a toss. And these Vaishyas were supposed to protect cow and agriculture. Earlier, it used to be like simple living and eye thinking. So all this thing you covered in last class. And you also mentioned all this classification was for men. And Sri Dharma was different. That was like taking care of family. Culture is transmitted by mother. And there were some 64 hearts which women used to get trained at home. And boys used to go to school. And girls used to learn at home only. And rangoli, cooking, singing, dancing, embroidery, all these kind of things, they were trained at home. And now how the women has changed due to modernization, that example you gave, like killing their own children, that abortion and all those things. And women are not ready to lactate the kids. All those things which has led imbalances in the society, you mentioned that. And in addition to this, the Sri Dharma was like, Brahmana's wife used to help her husband in doing puja and all. And Kshatriya's wife, when situation demanded, they used to be ready for landing up to the, for going to the war. And Vaishya's wife, based on emergency, they did their role also. So this is what you mentioned. and you said technology work were kind of asuras job and all those things you said.
Rudras,
and nowadays we are doing that coding, and that is not the way of life, you said. And you also mentioned one more thing was like grahasthas, they earn money, and at the age of 50 they should finish all grahastha activity, and they should not be taking care of grandchildren and all those things. They should indulge themselves in serving Lord. And then you said that you should give up attachment to life, give up attachment to materialistic stuff. So after grahastha, it's basically you should not have any attachment to the material life. Then that's when you can cross I and Me platform and take up the responsibility to serve Lord. And you also mentioned that discipline was a part of everybody's life. People used to live a content, happy life in olden days and not accumulating sins and all those things. And you also mentioned that there are three modes, that is goodness, passion, and ignorance. This is what I took a note from the last class. Thank you
very much. Okay, I think that was an excellent summary. So actually Krishna completes, discussed till second chapter verse 38, you know, which is jnana, which is atma jnana, and there's also karma kanda technically. So now today we're going to discuss the, you know, most important part of the second chapter, which is starting from verse 39. So I'll read the verse. Eshate bihita sankhe buddhir yogeti mam shunu buddhya yukto yaya partha karma bandham cha hasyasi. Translation: thus far I have described this knowledge to you through analytical study. Now listen as I explain in terms of working without fruitive results. Usana partha, when you act in such knowledge, you can free yourself from the bondage of works. So this is actually most important, you know, subject matter that Krishna is going to now start discussing. This is called Buddhi Yoga. Okay, Buddhi Yoga, or it is also called Bhakti Yoga. So Buddhi Yoga means we use our intelligence, which is Buddhi, to do yoga. Yoga is to connect with the Lord. Yoga means connection with the Lord. So how do we use our buddhi? What do we use our buddhi today? Where are all of us using our buddhi? Most of us are using our buddhi to work for others, isn't it? So this buddhi yoga means that whatever buddhi we are using, whatever intelligence we are using to work, the results of that work has to be offered to Krishna. The work that we do by using our buddhi, the results of that work has to be offered to Krishna. This is buddhi yoga. Okay? So what do? We use our buddhi, we work, we get salary. Isn't it? Now, what do we do with that salary? What do we do with the salary we earn? Anybody wants to share? What do we do with the money?
Use for family.
We use for family. Okay. What for the family? What do we do for the family?
Enjoyment. Food.
Enjoyment. Going out, eating, buying clothes. Yeah. So many things we do, right? So we use money that we earn for sense gratification, gratify our senses, to gratify our tongue, to gratify our eyes, to gratify our ears, gratify all our senses. What Krishna is saying is that the way you connect with me is by using the money that you earn. Use that money for serving me. It's so simple. So previously we discussed about this Varnashrama. Now, obviously, ideally, in an ideal society, Varnashrama is considered as a basis for cultured human society. But unfortunately, in Kali Yuga, this Varnashrama is gone, right? Like nobody's following Varnashrama. while it is important to set up Varnashrama, till we come, we are able to come to the platform of Varnashrama, whatever work we are doing, whatever form we are doing, the results have to be offered to Krishna. This is Buddhi Yoga. So instead of living for sense gratification, we live to earn money to serve the Lord. Actually, previously when Srila Prabhupada went to the US to preach, at that time, you know, he did not have any money. He started getting followers one by one. Now, to even run that particular preaching center that he was running, you know, obviously what Srila Prabhupada was doing was, he used to give fabulous prasadam and kirtan. These are the two things which attracted people those days. In fact, these are the cornerstones of bhakti. Actually, just think about it. Bhakti is so nice, so simple. Krishna says, susukam kartum abhyayam. It is very simple. What you need to do? Just sing, dance, and have prasadam. Will anybody not want to do this? Sing, dance, and have a nice prasadam. So Prabhupada was just doing that in the early days, right? But then in the US, you know, even to run that, to provide for prasadam to all the people who are coming, it used to be very difficult. So then those days, those devotees who used to come to Prabhupada, what they used to do is, they used to go for work, whatever, 10 to 5, 10 to 6, etc. They used to go. They used to come, earn whatever money they used to earn, they used to give it to Prabhupada, full money. And they used to just live in the center or go live somewhere near. They used to just depend on whatever Prabhupada used to do. This is the ideal standard that we earn. We give the money to our guru. Of course, you know, we can keep whatever is required for our normal basic maintenance and give the rest to guru. But, you know, these things are also not being followed. So then, you know, practically then people then, you know, said, okay, whether you can, if you can do 5%, if you can do 10%, whatever you can. Because if you say any number, then, you know, people will say, no, no, we have commitments and this and that. So the whole idea is you earn money, you take care of the requirements of your family and start giving at least some part of your result to Krishna. To the extent that we give to Krishna, to that extent our earning is purified. To the extent we give to Krishna, to that extent our earning is purified. What does that mean? Actually, whatever work we do in Kali Yuga, everything is sinful. Though we might think that, no, 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 I'm not doing any bad work. But Kali Yuga is so complex. We are sitting and doing some coding and that whatever program is used by some lecha, some meat eater somewhere else in the different other part of the world, we have to get that karma, right? So it's very complex. So whatever money we earn is fully sinful. So if we give some part of it to Krishna, to that extent, the sins are eliminated. So 100% sin versus, say, if I give 10%, I will only get 90% sin. 10% is purified. Now, the advantage of this 10% which is getting purified is that it slowly purifies us, right? And along with our chanting, along with our reading, other things that we are doing, we start giving money to Krishna. Then this purification actually helps grihasthas to progress. Actually, this has been one of the most important things that I did. At least, you know, I was told to do this and I took it very seriously. And fortunately, Krishna has helped me progress. Right, so this is Buddhi Yoga. Right, so just not living for sense gratification. Right, so we don't earn thinking that I want to do this, I want to do that. See, gradually, see, if you look at it, right, today, I mean, unfortunately, we have a second wave of, and it's so distressful, right? I mean, we went through a little bit of trouble, Krishna's mercy, it was very small. But we went through a little bit of a trouble and, you know, we can, whatever we speak, right, we experience, it's so horrible, it's so troublesome, it's so difficult. Right, so even whatever little sense gratification people used to do, that also is not available, right? What sense gratification will you go? due to everywhere now again, you know, restrictions. I mean, I just today took my mother to hospital for her eye checkup, and you know, just wearing that mask for 2-3 hours just makes it look like, you know, are we some kind of animals, right? You know, that you see that dog on the road, you know, sometimes the dogs are, their mouths are covered closed because they bark too much or they bite people, right? So their mouths are closed. Now, I mean, what kind of a life is this? And why are we experiencing this? Because we have done nonsense. We have done, try to do sense gratify ourselves, and in that process we have created sinful activities, so we have to suffer. So this sense gratification that we are looking for is not going to give us any happiness. It's just very illusory. Right now we are thinking, okay, I do something, I go and eat some stuff outside, it is nice, it is satisfying my taste buds, you know, but it results in sin. So we might think that we are enjoying today, but it's not really enjoyment, it's actually suffering. So what is the use of this kind of sense gratification? What is the use of living like this? Actually, Shastra says, Nate swartha vidum, nate swartha gatim hi Vishnu. Swartha, we all have to be swarthis, selfish. But we have to know our real self-interest. Our real self-interest is, nobody wants to, you know, be unhappy or go through suffering, right? But what is the use if you act in such a way that it results in suffering in the future? There's no use living like that, isn't it? So this life of sense gratification, living to gratify our senses, eating, sleeping, mating, defending, this is actually not happiness. Because see, previously, before Kali Yuga, all these activities also used to be guided as per scriptures. It used to be authorized activities, even enjoyment. You know, like even people used to enjoy by what? Sitting and watching a drama of, you know, Ramayana or Krishna Leela or something, right? That is their entertainment, which is not actually material at all. It is completely spiritual. So life used to be organized in such a way that there used to be very less chances of committing sin. But unfortunately, in Kali Yuga, it's just completely sinful. A start to end, it is sinful. So whatever we are thinking, we are enjoying, etc., is also going to result in future suffering. Right? So is Krishna is so mercifully giving us a solution, saying that don't keep accumulating sins. Whatever you earn, give the result to me, then you purify yourself. Of course, then we use money for basic maintenance, etc., right? I mean, everybody requires food, clothing. Prabhupada said that we should live comfortably. We're not saying that we should become like austere and give up food. No. Cook nice prasadam for Krishna, have prasadam. You know, so use whatever money, okay, decent clothing, living in a proper house, etc., all that is fine. But beyond that, you have propensity to go visit places, go to Holy Dham, go to Vrindavan, go to Mayapur, go to Tirupati, there's so many places. Go to Melukote. So whatever our propensities are, somehow we have to initially try to link it to Krishna. Then we get purified. Right? So because see, Arjuna's reasoning for not fighting was sense gratification. Because he said, I'm not going to enjoy. There's no fun, right? I'm going to win the kingdom and I can't share it with anybody. All my relatives would be dead. I don't want such a kingdom. So Arjuna's, and also his thing was, I mean, I am going to accumulate sin. So he was just thinking about himself, like we do, right? I and me and mine. So Arjuna was just thinking about it like we do, because he was showing us by his example how we live. So he said, okay, Krishna, I'm not going to follow your instruction because I don't think it's right. I want sense gratification. So his whole reason for not fighting was his own sense gratification, right? And he's showing that because people actually live life only for sense gratification. So you're showing, we live life for sense gratification. So now I take all my decisions based on sense gratification, right? And so he said, no, I'm not going to fight. So the solution to this subtle way of suffering, which we don't know that we are actually going to suffer because of this, but the laws of karma are so intricate that we will end up suffering. So the solution to that is that we give up the results of our work to. Okay, this is called Buddhi Yoga or Bhakti Yoga. So Buddhi Yoga or Bhakti Yoga, to be very precise, there are two aspects that we do. One is we directly do Navavidha Bhakti, which is chanting Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, Pada Sevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasam, Sattamatam, Yudanam. So we do chanting, reading, hearing, etc., which are direct devotional service. These are direct devotional service, activities of direct devotional service. Then there is this Karma Yoga, which is where we work and we use the results to serve Krishna. Both these, if we are able to do both these, then we're going to progress in bhakti. So now Krishna is going to say further few verses about what is the advantage of living a life like this. Now this is the life, right? So ideally, just to clarify, ideally, varnashrama dharma. So which means that our occupation is as per our varna and ashrama, and stri should follow stri dharma. This is topmost, right? Otherwise, whatever we are doing, we use the results, offer it to Krishna. Along with that, we live every day. We dedicate time for chanting, hearing, etc., and eat Krishna prasadam, etc. Right? Two activities of bhakti. This is the life. Now Krishna is saying, what is the use of living a life like this? What benefits will it give? Right? So please hear very attentively. These are all very, very important verses, because actually what we have been talking about so far, Krishna is saying in Bhagavad Gita, saying that this is how you have to live. Verse 40. Neha vikrama nashosti pratyavayona vidyate svalpamupyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. He says in this endeavor, what endeavor? This Buddhi Yoga, like what I described. There is no loss or diminution, and a little advancement on this path can protect one from the most dangerous type of fear. Okay. So let me ask a question. Kindly share your thoughts. What is the most dangerous type of fear? What do we fear most? Anybody? Any thoughts? Answers. What do we fear most? Nobody has this. Who wants anything?
Death.
Okay. So one is death. One is, you know, people fear death. What about, apart from that, is there anything else anybody can think of?
About our future.
Okay. So future, death. So more importantly, previously, actually, people were not so worried about death because they knew that death is anyway going to come. They were worried about not having a human form of life next in their next life, right? They were worried about actually going to animal life, right? Falling into lower species, right? So either to live a life forgetting Krishna, yes. So either death or about having a suitable situation to perform bhakti. So now when we start this process of Buddhi Yoga, then there is no fear. This fear goes off because one thing, three things are there. One is, for a devotee, there is no death. Okay. Hare Krishna, you're able to hear me, no? Okay, yeah. So for a devotee, there is no death, number one. Okay. And I'll explain what that means. Number two, once we start on this path, even a little advancement, we will continue this in the next life. Number two. So if we do up to 5% bhakti, then next life we'll continue from 6%. Right? And what is the third thing I wanted to say? Yeah, so maybe these two things only, let me explain. So first thing, there is actually for a devotee, there is no death. Real like death, like what we normally know. What does that mean? Actually, in Bhagavatam, there is this discussion about how Narada Muni, in his previous life, before he became Narada Muni. So Narada Muni in his previous life was a maid servant of a son of a maid servant, right? Now this maid servant, fortunately, she was working in an hermitage ashram of very great devotees. So once some very great devotees came there, and Narada Muni as a boy, still maybe 5 years old or something, right? He spent all his time sitting there, hearing what they have to say, doing service to them, and so on and so forth, right? So he was just spending all his time there. And so he was hearing, and they were talking Krishna Katha. And what happened to this boy? Slowly, steadily, he started developing attraction to hear about Krishna. Narada Muni says, though he was a small boy, he did not have any inclination to go and play sports and this and that and all that. He was a very grave child. And he used to serve, right? So they used to ask, okay, get us this, for whatever their puja, this, that and all that. So he used to serve them. So then, those sages stay there for 4 months of Chaturmasya. The monsoon period, and then after that they decide to go to do their preaching work. And actually then what happens is, once also he takes their permission and takes their remnants, uchista, right, what the remnants of their food. Actually in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that if we eat remnants of food of normal people, like generally, it is done, people in office, you take from, different people, one spoon from each person's plate or tiffin box or whatever. That is in the mode of ignorance. It's actually equivalent to eating like animals. Animals eat from each other's plates. They don't have any distinction. Human beings should not do that. But taking the remnants from a plate of a pure devotee, actually when we take these remnants, we are affected by the consciousness of the person who has eaten that food. So when we take some remnants from plate of a pure devotee, that pure devotee's consciousness, we get infected by that. Right? This is good infection, right? We get affected by their purity, right? So Narada Muni takes that remnants and he becomes very purified, and his consciousness also changes, and he develops attraction, and he's also anyway every day hearing about Krishna Katha. So he becomes very motivated. And even after they leave, and they explain, before they leave, go, they explain the confidential truth that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. We have to serve Krishna. We are servants of Krishna. So we have to serve Krishna, and this is the perfection of life. So they give him this knowledge, right? And then he is very happy, and then they leave. Then what happens is, after some time, his mother dies, bitten by a snake, very small boy. Now, because he had got all this knowledge, he was hearing all this knowledge from these great devotees, he looks at, the death of his mother, and he says, no, this is Lord's mercy. Lord wants me to spend all my life serving him. So then he goes, travels north. And in the description, it is said he travels through various places which are, very wealthy, prosperous cities, beautiful gardens, forests, etc., etc. But he's not attracted to by any of these. And then he goes to the north. Then he sits towards the Himalayas, and he sits somewhere and he starts doing meditation. And very soon the Lord appears in his heart, and Narada Muni gets vision of Lord Vishnu. But suddenly that vision goes away, and then Lord Vishnu announces to him, saying that, Narada, you will not be able to see me further in this life, but you continue your sadhana bhakti. And then from next life, you will always keep thinking about me. You will never forget me. Right? And then Narada Muni completes his sadhana at the end of his life. Bhagavatam describes, saying that death comes like lightning. Like lightning. Lightning means, at one stroke, that's it. Right? So for a devotee, death is just, actually, for a pure devotee, he is already spiritualized. His body is already spiritualized. That means that his body is not material at all. So our death, they basically just means that this material body goes and we get a spiritual body. That's it. So there is no pain and suffering in this. This death is not like other normal people dying, where, you know, a normal person dies and then he gets another material body. So to continue his suffering, right? The cycle of birth and death. But for a devotee, just this material body is gone, and a material body already would have been sufficiently spiritualized to the extent of our purification. And if you have achieved perfection, then we just regain our spiritual body, and then we just go back to Goloka. That's it. So there is no death. So by practicing this Buddhi Yoga, not just that, you know, at the end, we won't see what is called normal death. We won't see death. This death is like, you know, example is given of if a lion is holding a cub in its mouth, is there any fear for the cub? There's no fear for the cub, right? Because it's his mother. But if there is a kitten in the mouth of a lion, then kitten is scared because it's going to die soon. Right? So for devotees are like children of the Lord, right? Though everybody is children of the Lord, but we are obedient children, right? We are trying to be obedient. So Krishna has special mercy for us. He takes special care of us. So though death is very scary, for devotees, there is no death. Because death, which is just a representation, which is kala, time, which is just one of the forms of the Lord, strength, you know, energy of the Lord, it just holds the devotee like a baby, like, you know, like its own. So we're not going to go through this general suffering that death gives people. Right? So the only solution, when we look at all this trouble that is happening around us, the only solution is Krishna Bhakti. There is no other solution. There's nothing else which can actually protect us. People keep saying, wear mask properly, do this, do that, wash your hand. Do we think that wearing the mask or washing our hand will protect us from the virus? Virus has to come, it will come. The only person who can protect is Krishna. So Krishna Bhakti, right? So this Bhakti, it will never get destroyed. So if we do, the second part is like, if you do 5%, you will continue from 6% next level. So there's also this beautiful discussion about Ajamila. Ajamila was a devotee when he was small, but then when his father was a worshipper of Narayana, and he used to help his father in puja and, you know, everything at home. And he was a very devout Brahmana, but then he's married, gets a very qualified wife. But one point of time, what happens is he's in the forest, goes to the forest to get some twigs and roots, etc., for some sacrifice for his father. And those days, not Kali Yuga, very sattvic life. But he sees one Vaishya, one prostitute, and one Shudra, low-class man. The low-class man is hugging the prostitute in the forest somewhere, not in public, like it happens nowadays. Everything is public nowadays. Private life of husband and wife is also public. So gross, actually. Yeah. Anyway, so he sees her, he sees them, these two, you know, low-born people acting in a way, and suddenly his, you know, some kama, some desire in his heart is awakened. And then he develops a desire to keep that prostitute in his house. So he gives up his parents, he gives up his wife. He does all kinds of nonsense to actually take care, keep this prostitute happy. And he does all kinds of sinful stuff, right? But because he had done some devotional service in the beginning, Lord did not leave him, right? So at the age of 80, he gives birth to a child, and by the Lord's inspiration, he calls him Narayana. He calls the child Narayana. And he's so attached to his young child, right? He keeps saying, Narayana, come here, Narayana, sit, Narayana, take food, Narayana, go there, Narayana, why are you doing this? Narayana, Narayana, Narayana. This is Nama Japa. But he was not doing it thinking that it is Krishna or he is Narayana. He is just saying, okay, this is my son's name. So then what happens? Then time for death comes. Bhagavatam describes. After we finish Bhagavad Gita, we'll go into Bhagavatam. Hopefully, we can progress fast. So Bhagavatam describes saying that Ajamila is sleeping, then in his sleep, it's like some bad dream. You know, there are some very ugly looking people he's seeing in his dream. And those ugly looking people are coming to him and they're, you know, trying to put somebody is putting a rope around his neck. And he's in fear, frightened by looking at them. And what happens when we are very afraid? We call out our dearest ones. So he calls out his son's name, Narayana, please come and help me. He did not call Narayana, called his son Narayana. But as soon as he calls Narayana, Vishnu Dutas, who are messengers of Vishnu in Vaikuntha, they hear, oh, who is this? Helplessly calling out for our Lord. Let us go and help him out. Vishnu Dutas are always waiting to look at where devotees are facing trouble. How can we help them? So we should never feel ourselves left out or alone or anything like that. As long as there is Krishna's name in our tongue, you know, we have all the protection in this world. All the protection. So Vishnu Dutas immediately come, and then Ajamila is seeing in his sleep, in his like dream, oh, now some very beautiful, effulgent, four-armed you know, people have come. And then there is argument going on between this four-armed people and the Yamadutas, the Vishnu Dutas and Yamadutas. And finally, the Yamadutas are driven away. And then Vishnu Dutas also go from there. And then suddenly Ajamila is woken up. Then he realizes, oh, this actually was my death. By Lord Narayana's mercy, I have actually got rebirth. Then what he does, for the rest of his life, he goes to Rishikesh and he practices Bhakti Yoga. He practices Bhakti Yoga. So even though he's, and he achieves perfection, goes back to Vaikuntha. So in his childhood, he had done some Bhakti. It did not give up on him. Lord Narayana did not give up on him. When he was old, Narayana somehow gave mercy to him. Right? And helped him so that he could achieve perfection in one life. This is the power of bhakti. This is the power of nama. So that is why we give so much of emphasis to nama, nama. Chanting. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. There is no other way, there is no other way, there is no other way. So in chanting the holy name, there are three levels. First level is called nama aparadha. Offensive chanting. So on the group, I will post a link which has 10 offenses. Okay, so so 10 offenses against the holy name. You can search on internet. So there are 10 offenses I have posted on the group. The first offense is to blaspheme the devotees. Let me just share this. Yeah, so the first offense is to blaspheme the devotees who have dedicated their lives for propagating the holy name of the Lord. So blaspheme the devotees. Say sometimes people call devotees bad names, saying that, you know, these people are useless, they are, you know, not doing any work, they are parasites, this, that, and all that. So we should not. Second, to consider the names of demigods like Lord Shiva or Lord Brahma to be equal or independent of the name of Lord Vishnu. No, nobody is independent of Lord Vishnu. And Brahma and Shiva are not same as Vishnu. Right? So we should not think about them like that. So we should have this clarity in our mind. To disobey the orders of the spiritual master. This is for those who are initiated. Or even like what Prabhupada is saying, if there is, we look at, when you're reading, something looks like an order, we should try to follow it. To blaspheme the Vedic scriptures in pursuance of the Vedic vision. Sometimes people call Vedic scriptures as imaginary, this, that, and all that. That also should be, should not be. To consider the glories of chanting Hare Krishna to be an imagination. Now, glories of chanting Hare Krishna, actually, Shastra says that if we chant one name, without offense. These are all offenses, right? So when we are chanting without offense, even one nama, if it chant without offense, it can clear more sins than we can commit. It can clear more sins than we can actually commit. So powerful the nama, right? But then when we say this, people say, no, this is all exaggeration, imagination. That is also nama aparad. Aparad. So offenses means aparad. So we're talking about 10 nama aparad. Sixth, to give some interpretation to the holy name of the Lord. So we say, oh, holy name, it means something, this, that. No, very clear. Hare means Radha, Krishna means Krishna. Right? We are just taking the names of Radha and Krishna. There is no other interpretation required. To commit sinful activities on the strength of holy name. See, holy name is so powerful that we actually, you can chant on one side and do commit sinful activities on the other. But that's not encouraged. Because the holy name protects us. Holy name is non-different from Krishna and the holy name protects us. Right? So, but we should not commit sinful activities in the strength of the holy name. To consider the chanting of Hare Krishna as one of the auspicious activities like Karma Kanda. It's like, oh, some good activity. I'm doing some good activity. Punya Karya. Yeah, it's not like normal Punya Karya. It is transcendental. To instruct a faithless person about the glories of holy name. So generally, you know, when you bring somebody new to Krishna consciousness, etc., we just simply tell them chant Hare Krishna. We don't tell them about all the glories of chanting Hare Krishna. And finally, the most importantly, to not have complete faith in the chanting of the holy name and to maintain material attachments even after understanding so many instructions in the talk. Also offensive to be inattentive while chanting. So mostly, most of the devotees get stuck here. Right? These nine somehow are okay. Over a period of time, we overcome all these. So please go through this once and make sure that you're not committing any of these nine offenses. Now this 10th offense we will be committing because we may not have complete faith in the chanting of the holy name. And we also continue to maintain material attachments. Right? And more importantly, it is offensive to be inattentive while chanting. Right? So he says, see, every devotee who claims to be a Vaishnava must guard against these offenses in order to quickly achieve the desired success, Krishna prema. This is what we are chanting for. What is our goal of our chanting? To achieve Krishna prema. Okay, so if we do, so why am I saying that? So this is nama aparadha. This is chanting with aparadha. Okay, now the second stage in chanting is called nama bhasa. Nama bhasa is where none of these aparadhas are happening, but it is not shuddha nama. The third stage is shuddha nama, pure name. Okay, when we chant pure name, then we will develop Krishna prema. Okay, but in the second level where it is nama bhasa, it's neither nama aparadha, which is the starting stage, nor is it shuddha nama. It is such that because there is no offenses, one will get liberated, right? Like what happened here, Ajamila, by speaking Narayana without intention. Actually, this is one of the types of nama bhasa. It's not intentional. It's simply like, you know, without seriousness, some, you know, an indirect indication to the Lord. He called his son. But because it was Lord's name, Lord took it as saying, no, he's chanting my name. When somebody chants in this nama bhasa, they actually get liberated. They can go out of this material world. It's so powerful. Chanting is so powerful. Right? So we will, if we chant sincerely and try to focus on every nama, you know, without distraction, we will achieve great results. We'll achieve great results. But we should not chant and expect material prosperity, etc. That is why then it becomes like ordinary karma kanda, like ordinary fruitive activities for some material benefits. No, we should chant with our goal is to get Krishna prema. We'll talk about this Krishna prema and all later, right? We are very far from Krishna prema right now. Right? But the idea is this whole process of bhakti, buddhi, yoga is such that once we start, you know, we will just keep continuing. We already now started on our path back to Godhead, back to Krishna. Now it is totally dependent on us, whether we want to achieve it in one life, whether we want to achieve it in multiple lives, that is up to us. It's a choice. Because Prabhupada said, if you follow the process, chant minimum 16 rounds every day, follow the four regulative principles. What are the four regulative principles? No meat eating, no intoxication, no gambling, no illicit relation with illicit relations. That's it. These are four, very easy for Indians to follow. Not very difficult. four regulative principles, minimum 16 rounds. If we follow this, we will definitely go back to Krishna in this life. This is Prabhupada's assurance. But we have to be serious. We have to be serious about it. Not time pass. So minimum 16 rounds we have to chant and follow four regulative principles, eat Krishna prasadam, then we'll achieve perfection. Now, in case for some reason we don't complete our process this life, no worry. If you finish 50% from next life, we'll continue from 51%, achieve perfection. Whatever, right? Wherever we left off, we will continue from next life. So powerful. So either it's this life or next life, or of course, like I said, you know, if we want another 10 lives to live in this material world, it's our choice. But the process will empower us to go back to Krishna in this life. Right? So here Krishna is saying, okay, even little advancement is good. Lot of advancement is very good. Even little advancement. We do little and for some reason we live bhakti. I pray that nobody, it doesn't happen to anybody. Right? But still, if that happens also, there is no loss. Because bhakti is so powerful. Right, and in verse 41, Krishna says, Vyavasayatmika buddhi ekeha kurunandana bhushakaya nantashta buddhaya vyavasayanam. He's saying, but those who are on this path, they must be single point focused, completely resolute in their determination. There is only one goal for them. This Krishna Prema. That is the only goal. Not Krishna Prema and my promotion at work and my salary increase and my buying a site and this and that, no. Single pointed focused. I want to achieve perfection. I want to get out of this material world, this life. I want to achieve Krishna Prema. I want to go back to Krishna and serve Him in the spiritual world. This should be our only goal. So He's saying one should be determined with single pointed focus. And Prabhupada actually, when he read this verse, you know, sometime when he was doing sadhana bhakti, at one point of time, he decided, I'm going to dedicate my life to the instruction of my Guru Maharaj. Just to preach Krishna consciousness in the West. If he had not done that, we would not be sitting here and discussing. Right? He committed based on this verse, after hearing this verse. Vyavasayatmika buddhi. So I'm going to talk more about this Vyavasayatmika buddhi next week. Very important verse. But please understand the glory of bhakti. I'm just trying to give you a glimpse of how glorious bhakti is. But for that, first we have to get over sense gratification, sense attachments. Okay, any questions? I will stop there. We finish 39:40 and the introduction to 41. Anybody has any questions? Are we serious about this? So my question, right? Because see, why we are trying to spend all this time coming together, discuss all this? Because we want people to become serious about this path of bhakti. Right? Prabhupada created this ISKCON as a movement, as an institution for pure devotional service. Right? So our intention is that everybody should make this the only goal of their life. So I'm going to have like 5 minutes of interaction. Okay. I request all of you, if possible, if you can please, you know, not everybody will do, but if you, a lot of Mataji is here, but if you can, you know, just a video for 5 minutes and say, like, you know, are you serious about bhakti? Are you serious to make bhakti your single goal in this life? I'm going to ask each and every person because we have only very few. If you are not, it's okay. But I want you to become conscious about this. Right? Become conscious that you are not serious about bhakti. And then what is important is for you to think about, why am I not still serious? What is preventing me from taking this path seriously? Right? Why do I have other things? Why do I have other goals? Right? And if you think this question is irrelevant, you please let me know that, you know, this reason I don't think this question is relevant. Right? But if you say yes, please understand, this is not to satisfy me or to... You can tell me whatever you feel like, right? But who is hearing? Krishna is hearing, right? So if you say yes, please note Krishna is hearing. If you say no, it's okay. No problem, right? There is no right or wrong answer here. But you know, we've been doing these classes for so many days. So I also wanted to understand, saying that how many of us are really serious about this part? Serious means then you have to do some hard work, right? Is that okay? Okay, so I'm going to start here in order. Medha, are you serious about bhakti? Hare Krishna. Okay, not answering is not an option.
Not that. I am, but I'm not able to dedicate time as required. So I will plan my schedule to dedicate more time.
Okay, it's fine. See, the desire. See, I'll tell you one more thing in bhakti, right? What is more important, most important, is the desire in our heart. If you have a sincere desire saying, Krishna, I want to serve you. I want to follow your instructions. I want to live a life like you want me to. Krishna will give mercy. This path of bhakti is not, we are not alone. Krishna will handhold us at every step. But what is important is our sincere desire. Everything starts from a desire. So if we have a sincere desire, it's okay. We might have practical problems. That's okay. That's understandable. You don't have to worry about that. Okay?
Yeah.
Next. Thank you. More Purnima Mataji. Purnima Mataji.
Ah, Prabhuji.
Yes. Huh? You're saying something? Hare Krishna?
Nothing, Prabhuji.
No, I'm asking a question. My question is that, are we serious about bhakti? Is this the only goal of our life?
Yes, that's true.
Okay, so you are clear
I am doing it, like chanting and taking Krishna prasadam.
Yeah, no, but I'm saying, my question is saying that there are other things that we'll have to do in the future, but we are clear that, okay, I want to follow this path. I want to achieve perfection in this life.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, Rupa Mataji. Unmute yourself, please. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Yes.
Yeah,
bro. What? No sound at all.
I'm serious about the... Seva.
Okay, very nice. So this should be your last life in this material world, right?
Yes, Prabhu.
Okay. Satish Chandra
Hare
Prabhu.
Krishna.
Hare Krishna, thank you. Satish Chandra Prabhu.
Yeah, Prabhu. I am also not perfectly, Prabhu. 50% only I'm focused on chanting only. I'm not perfectly reading the books only. Also videos and chanting only now. I'm starting to take seriously only 2 days. Not perfect.
But do you have sincere desire to say that bhakti is the only way of life? I mean, do you understand that this is the only path that you want to take, or you're still not clear? Are you sure that you want to follow bhakti and achieve perfection in this life?
Yes, 100%.
Okay. Madhurya Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Prabhuji, I'm very serious in serving the Lord.
Okay, you're okay.
Yes.
Dhruvi Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, desire is there.
Desire is there, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, Seturaman Prabhu. I know answer is yes, but I'm just asking. Okay, Usha Mataji, I don't know if I know you. Usha Mataji, is this the first time you joined our online class? Okay. Gangaya Prabhu, is this Aditya Prabhu? Or this is Komala Mataji's? Gangaya Prabhu? Okay, I think whoever answered, at least all of you are clear. and that is nice, because you know, pray to Krishna every day. You know, especially if you are sincere and you don't have time or you want to do more, pray to Krishna, or you can contact me for any guidance. The idea is, you know, this is the only thing, and this is so beautiful and blissful also. It's not just it's some, you know, boring or actually there's so much of you know, it gives us real happiness, right? Though we don't seek for it, but it gives us happiness because it satisfies the soul. And that is this process of bhakti. So thank you everybody for joining, and please kindly continue your activities of chanting, hearing, having Krishna prasadam. Reduce life of sense gratification as much as possible. Use your earnings in the service of Krishna. Already so many devotees are doing, they are contributing to whatever extent is possible from their side for helping us run our center, etc. I thank all of you, you know, bottom of my heart for these contributions, because it helps us keep our center running. Others who are not doing, I request that you can also do if it is possible. If your financial commitments allow you to do that, right? And all of us, let us work together and progress on this path of bhakti and make sure that we achieve perfection this life and don't come back again to this material world of suffering. Okay. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Shri Prabhupada ki jai. Samaveta Gaura Bhakti. There are no other questions. We can continue. Okay, thank you so much for joining. Krishna willing, we'll again meet next time. Hare
Krishna. Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.